All right, so 2 Kings chapter 9, and as I mentioned, a message I've titled, Live in Peace, Free of Fear. And that's not to, you know, I know we have a lot of talk of fear today, a lot of talk of fear mongering, a lot of things just, you know, in a sense, from a strictly human level, perhaps, to be afraid of. So I don't minimize the reality of the situation that we find ourselves in. I don't certainly don't criticize the emotion that we can have raise up from time to time that creates fear in us. But I want to talk about some principles of how to combat that and some things that we can apply to our lives, right? I mean, because sometimes, you know, when we talk about fear, we can either kind of be overwhelmed by it, or we can almost pretend like, you know, you're not saved if you're afraid. You know what I mean? Kind of these extremes. When in reality, fear is something that rears its ugly head. But God says He hasn't given us a spirit of fear. And so how can we combat just the reality of things in life that are unsettling and might tend to create that? So today in this passage, we're going to see some principles. Look at a few principles as we often do, going through God's Word verse by verse. To see how we can combat that. Just some things that we can be aware of, and then perhaps some things we can do. So in 2 Kings chapter 9, we continue through this exciting story, really, of Elisha the prophet and his life and his ministry to the nation of Israel for the Lord during interesting times. And so verse 1, we'll take a peek here at the first 10 verses and then chat a little bit. So then Elisha the prophet called one of the sons of the prophet. So remember, this would be like a student to him, right? Remember, we saw just in the last couple of weeks, they built a bigger school, right? And some cool lessons through that. And so this would have been one of the students there that he's talking to here. And he says, tie up your garments and take this flask of oil in your hand and go to Ramoth Gilead. When you arrive, look there for Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, son of Nimshi, and go in and have him rise among his fellows and lead him to an inner chamber. We'll see that this is actually pretty specific to even where everybody's hanging out at when he arrives. So like Elisha so often did, had some great details by the Spirit of God. Then take the flask of oil and pour it on his head. And say, thus says the Lord, I anoint you king over Israel. Then open the door and flee, do not linger. Right? And so this wouldn't be the first time that that Jehoshaphat here, right, Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, is anointed king. But we'll see that this is the time that's for him to step out and actually take the lead. Remember back in 1 Kings, it was actually predicted that he would be king. So the young man, verse 4, the servant of the Lord, of the prophet, went to Ramoth Gilead, and when he came, behold, the commanders of the army were in council. And he said, I have a word for you, O commander. And Jehu said, to which of us all? And he said, to you, O commander. So he arose, and he went into the house, and the young man poured oil on his head, saying to him, thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord, God of Israel, I anoint you king over the people of the Lord, over Israel. And you shall strike down the house of Ahab, your master, so that I may avenge on Jezebel the blood of my servants, the prophets. Remember again, another prophecy previously foretold that, in fact, we'll see it very specifically lived out here shortly. And the blood of all the servants of the Lord for the whole house of Ahab shall perish. Ahab, remember, the most wicked king, right? And so this prophecy of the end of his reign is being lived out here. And I will cut off from Ahab every male, bond or free in Israel, and I will make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah. And the dog shall eat Jezebel in the territory of Jezreel, and none shall bury her. Then he opened the door, and he fled. And so here we see, you know, Jehu, of course, is a commander of the army of Israel. And you know, he served under Ahab and the son Joram. And as I mentioned earlier, I think it was back in 1 Kings chapter 19, that this prophecy was told to him previously, that he would, in the future, right, be anointed to come in and overthrow this, the lineage of Ahab, this wicked king who God had foretold through his prophets that would come to an end. And so now this young prophet, this student really of Elisha, is called to go and basically say, now's the time, right? You know, and because it had been predicted a long time ago, and he knew that he would be the one. And we'll see here that he actually knew details about, you know, some of the things that he was to carry out. And so he's encouraged here to, you know, now is the time. And so it's interesting that although this was foretold some time in the past, that the time is now at hand. And, you know, perhaps God has spoken something to your heart. Right? There's things that God burdens on us, and sometimes it's for now, sometimes it might be for a later time. But here we'll see that he calls him to go and to do that. And so as we go on, he says, when Jehu came out of the servants of his master, they said to him, "Is all well? Why did this mad fellow come to you?" And so comes, you know, picture the scene. He comes walking out, dripping with oil, right? He had just been anointed with oil, and there was this council. Remember, they were in council when he arrived, and they say, you know, "It's all well. Why did this, you know, crazy guy come to you?" And he said to them, "You know the fellow and his talk." And so, in other words, he's kind of not dismissing it, but he's not wanting to tell them right away what has been said. And they said, "That is not true. Tell us now." And he said, "Thus and so he spoke to me, saying, 'Thus says the Lord, I anoint you king over Israel.' Then in haste, every man of them took his garment, put it under on the bare steps, and they blew the trumpet and proclaimed that Jesus is king." So it's interesting here. God is bringing about judgment on the house of Ahab, right? He had warned of it from times past, and we'll see it actually carried out here in a little bit. But our principle here that I think is important for us to grasp in our time today, even though there was a lapse of time from the time it was foretold, and you could argue that King Ahab got away with a lot, right? And that his lineage had got away with a lot, and you might be tempted to stand back and question, where's the justice in this, right? Where's God in this? But we'll see here that as was predicted back in 1 Kings chapter 19, our first point is that God's justice will be served on the unrepentant. And it'll happen in God's time, right? And so we might look around today. In fact, I would suggest we probably do look around today, and we see just a lot of wrong, you know? And you know, I'm like the rest of us. We get frustrated at, you know, sometimes it seems like people are competing who can do the most ridiculous thing and get away with it, or what leader even in certain cities can make the most absurd decrees and get away with it. And you go, where's the justice? You might be tempted to think, where's the justice? Well, a takeaway that we can have from this passage is that God's justice will be served. I say that one way or the other, it's going to be served, right? For us as believers, and for those who would come to Christ, which is our heart's desire, right, for everybody, is to come to Christ and be part of the repentant, right? Because then justice has already been served on Jesus Christ. He's taken it for us, and we can walk in the joy and the peace of the Holy Spirit, right? But God's justice will be served on the unrepentant. And it'll be served at this time. So we can take rest in that. You know, even as we look around and we see the difficulty, and you guys know me, I'm all for speaking up and trying to affect change for the good, right, for the glory of God, because people are suffering, Right? People are suffering under wrong. People are suffering under poor leadership and suffering under poor decisions being made. But, you know, there's only so much we can do. We do look around and we see, how are some of these folks getting away with this? And it hopefully brings us some peace to realize that at the end of the day, they're not going to. Right? And not that we want to see them, you know, burn in hell or something like that. We want to see everybody repent and follow Christ. But the choice ultimately is up to them. So they either repent now and become part of the solution, which would be the ideal, right? A lot of the things being promoted today aren't really to solve anything in any real manner. And so it can be comforting for us to realize that God's justice will be served. And hopefully, too, that part of that message would help people awaken to the truth of that and what that means for their lives, for those who continue on in sin and in blatantly harming people and such. And so it's interesting. I would encourage us, don't give up, right? You hear me? For honestly, even if, you know, I was thinking about this, and you know, if you've you know, the church now has a YouTube channel. We've been doing these 5-minute videos just kind of encourage people during the week. I don't know about you, but I need, you know, to be in the Word a lot more often than once a week. And so we get out some messages to encourage folks in that, and to you know, really keep our eyes fixed where they need to be on the Lord. And it's interesting here, and I think it's good for us to realize that you know, God is still on the throne, right? God's still in control. And we've been talking about revival for a long time and praying for revival for a long time. And it's my firm conviction that still is the only real hope, right? It is that people repent and start to do what is right because it's right, right? Because they honor God, you know, the true and the living God. And that regardless of what my government says, regardless of what this leader says or this group of people says, I'm going to do what is right according to God's word, right? That's when real change will start to happen in our country. And so we all have an opportunity to play a part in that, right? To help people see the reality of the consequences of their actions, and then the reality of eternity and the decisions that we make that impact that. And it's good for us to realize, just like we see in this passage, the nation of Israel had clearly abandoned the Lord. Right? And if you look around at many of the conduct in our country, it's super easy to come to the conclusion that our country has abandoned the Lord, you know, perhaps some time ago. The cool thing to see here is that God had not abandoned Israel, right? And God has not abandoned the United States of America. And most importantly, God has not abandoned his church. Right now, obviously, there could come a time of judgment. Some might argue we're in there. I wouldn't argue against that. You know, clearly, God wants to see correction in our country. Right? He wants to see change in the lives of our country. But know this, and I like what David Gusick says. Though Israel had abandoned God, God had not abandoned Israel. He still had the right to interfere among them. To intervene, right? The idea is to intervene to affect change. And he's doing that in this passage. He would appoint and allow kings as he chose, either to bless an obedient Israel. It's kind of an interesting perspective, right? The nation follows the Lord and God blesses them with a godly leader. Or curse a nation with a disobedient nation with a certain type of leader, right? So, you know, according to the terms of his covenant. So what David Gusick is saying is that, you know, God did not give up on the nation of Israel, right? He still has the right all along to intervene, to bless, or to bring correction. And so hopefully that brings a little bit of encouragement to us. G. Campbell Morgan said, it is indeed a terrible chapter. That's kind of, I think, maybe old English, you know, a frightening chapter is kind of the idea, in which the truth of the divine government is written no longer in the gentle words of patient mercy, but in flames of fire. In other words, God is, through a difficult way, bringing correction to the nation of Israel, and in fact to the household of Ahab, as he predicted long ago. And it's going to be, as we get to the end of the chapter, we'll see it's going to be a little messy, if you will. And I think personally that's part of the issue in our culture, is that some leaders think that it's easier to say no, basically, to good and honest people than it is to say no to people who are committing crime. And unfortunately, we're seeing the results of that, right? We're seeing, you know, cities burn, and we're seeing people harmed. And we'll see, as God cleans up this household here, it gets a little messy. And the truth is, when people choose the way of crime for God's righteousness, right, to prevail, for honesty and for you know, law and order to prevail, it gets sometimes a little messy. And I think to a degree, some leaders have lost heart for that. You know, we see the results, tragic results, in many cities and some states and in our country. And but as the sad truth of all that is, people are getting hurt, right? You know, unfortunately, it's just more of the honest and hardworking people. I think of the folks that are trapped in some of these cities that can't leave, you know, and such. And so know, though, that God has not abandoned us. He hadn't abandoned the nation of Israel, and he's not going to abandon his church for sure. And so the best idea, realizing that God's judgment will be served on the unrepentant, right, is to turn and follow Jesus, right, and to encourage the real solution, which is revival. Right? And then revival, as I think it was Finney who said, revival is basically one person at a time choosing to repent and follow God, right, to change their ways. And that's what revival is. You know, I love mass evangelism. You know, I love, boy, when we were in Southern California, Harvest Crusade, I was there 4 nights in a row. You know, I got saved in May of 93, and that July or August, whatever month, the harvest, I didn't know you were supposed to go through this training and all this stuff to go help on the field, right? And if you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. And so they had an announcement on the radio, hey, if you've been trained, and I guess I overlooked that part. I just showed up, hey, I'm here to go help counsel people, you know, and I've been saved a few months, and somehow I ended up on the field doing it. You know, I think contacted somebody, whatever, but nevertheless, just out there, you know, that's the best solution. I know in my life, and I've shared this, and like any of us who, you know, got saved in an older time in our life, I used to have a lot of views that I don't hold today, you know, and it wasn't sitting down reasoning with someone. It was the Holy Spirit that changed me, right, inside. He gave my life to Jesus, and he changed me, and it didn't all happen immediately. I wish God would just, like, you know, clean you up and, you know, keep you clean, you know, automatically without you having to make decisions, because sometimes they make dumb ones, you know. But nevertheless, know that his justice will be served. And so the best solution is just to follow him, right? And then secondly, we see here also that God provides us the opportunity to be part of his plan in people's lives, right? And so we have a choice there too, right, to respond and be a part, alongside folks, you know, share with folks, encourage folks, or not. But we just read here that both the prophet, right, who went and he shared the message, you know, they thought he was crazy. Anybody ever think you're crazy for believing what you believe? Right? Anybody ever think you're crazy at the family, you know, holiday gatherings, for gathering around and, you know, giving thanks beforehand? Anybody ever think you're crazy for, you know, thinking that it's better to be honest, right, than just to try to get everything that you can get? You know, anybody ever think you're crazy for promoting things like honor and integrity? You know, you those words, you know, I wear a little band of honor on it, because I think that that's not talked about enough. It's not cared about enough in our culture, the idea of being honorable, doing the right thing, no matter who's watching or when it is. And so God gives us the opportunity, though, to be a part of his plan in people's lives. Just like a couple examples here. First is the prophet who went and shared this word, not knowing how it would be received, by the way. And then secondly, the men who were there, who remember when he didn't want to go out, where are we at there? When Jehu came out in verse 11, and they said, what did this crazy guy say? And he said, oh, just, you know, nothing. And they realized, oh, he's not being honest. Like, tell us what it was. And then they basically encouraged him. Right? He told them there in verse 12 that he anointed him king over Israel. And then they were very quick, right? In haste, every one of them took off his garment and put it under the bear stand. In other words, they sort of indicated allegiance to him, encouraged him. It's time. It's time to do this, right? You're going to face adversity, right? We're going to find out against a weak leader that there actually isn't a whole bunch of adversity, but he didn't know that at the time. I think that if we started having more stronger leaders push back on some of the weak leaders, you might find the same thing. Right? Start doing the right thing because it's the right thing, and see, you know, number one, you have God on your side, right? And see what happens. But God provides us the opportunity to do that, just like he provided them. And we have the opportunity today to, in fact, we just did one of those 5-minute videos on being part of the solution. Right? We have an opportunity. Jump with me real quick over to Ephesians chapter 2. And the cool thing about this is it's not like we have to come up with this, or, you know, we have to sort of make our own way, right? According to Ephesians chapter 2, God has actually done it for us. And we just have the honor and the privilege of walking in that truth. In chapter 2, pick it up in verse 8, right? We're all very familiar with this passage. For grace, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It's the gift of God. It's not a result of our works, so that no one may boast. That's good to remember, too. When God uses you or blesses you in some capacity, don't take the credit. It's the Lord, right? And, you know, we have the honor of participating, stepping out in faith and obedience, right? But check out verse 10. For we are his workmanship. And that word there in Greek is poema, and it can also be translated masterpiece. You think of a potter, right? Back in the old days, if you've seen the demonstration, you know, of a pottery, it starts off with just this lump of sort of wet clay. It looks kind of messy, frankly, right? And if you've seen them do it, their hands get all messy, and splatters all over them and stuff. But as they mold this clay, and it's on this wheel that's spinning, you know, and it at various speeds, they take it, and in the hand of this professional, right, it turns into this beautiful pot, right? And that's the idea here, is that we are his masterpiece. We're created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them, right? So hopefully that's comforting to all of us, that number one, you're God's masterpiece. Hope you see yourself. We can get so down on ourselves. We know our own hearts all too well. We can think, you know, any number of bad things about ourselves. But the Bible says that you're his masterpiece. You're his prized possession. Right? He sees you that way. He loves you. The Bible says also that we are created in Christ Jesus for good works. Right? And not only that, but those works that God has prepared beforehand for us just to walk in. In other words, God has blazed the way. God has made the path. God has laid out these good works. He's gone before. He's prepared the soil. He's done the things around it for us to walk in. It doesn't mean it's always easy, but it's a lot easier than going in the other direction. Just ask Jonah, right? Go in the direction that God has for us, and we get to participate in the work that he is doing. Right, he provides us opportunity to be a part of his plan. Jump with me also over back a little bit, actually, to Galatians chapter 9. Or excuse me, Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. I know what you just immediately you guys are thinking, hey, there is no Galatians 9, right? Galatians 6, verse 9 says, let us not grow weary while doing good. You know, you ever try to help someone, you ever you know, do good things, and it just seems like, what difference does it make? It seems like I'm just, you know, wasting my time. You ever get tired of getting up and just then doing the right thing? You know, we get up and go to work, and, you know, we do our best to care for our families and to take care of our responsibilities, and then, you know, life is messy, right? Some challenge or difficulty or trouble comes up, and we just keep on doing what God has called us to do. We do our best to be faithful. And so he says, don't grow weary of doing good. In other words, don't give up. You might get tired, but don't give up. For in due season, we will reap if we don't give up. In other words, you'll see the benefits. You'll see the results. Right? But don't give up on doing the right thing. And then he goes on and he says the super important thing. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Right? And so sometimes people will say, oh, you're being selfish. You know, sometimes people call and they want help or something. And it's always interesting to me when, and we do what we can, you know, just have to exercise some discernment. There's a lot of people that are trying to take advantage of churches and stuff. And it's always interesting when, you know, the answer is no, and you hear all sorts of vile words, like you sort of think, okay, I think I made the right decision, and one of those things is like, if you know, we've kind of done what we can do inside the body of Christ, that's where we look first, and based upon this passage is what God would have for us. And sometimes people don't think that's right, but there it is, right? Let us do good, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Doesn't mean we don't do good outside the body of Christ. But there's wisdom in a local body taking care of each other, right? Number one, you know, I'm not going to take advantage of, right? And I'm never worried. In fact, one time I remember we helped, you know, a decade ago or more. And I was just, out of curiosity, I Googled this person kind of after the fact. And it was interesting how he had gone on this prayer blog and talked about how he feels guilty taking advantage. He mentions this pastor in West Des Moines. I'm like, oh, I guess maybe... You know, it was like a night in the hotel, so it wasn't a huge thing. But my first clue was when I showed up at the hotel and gave the check, and they're kind of like, you know, this guy. I'm like, no. Lesson learned. But anyways, there's a reason. There's a lot of wisdom in caring for the body of Christ, right? And then doing what we can outside of that as the Lord leads. And I've learned to be much more attentive to that. Cursing me out for saying no, I understand even more so. So, number one, right, realize that God's justice will be served. We can get worked up, we can get fearful thinking that everybody's just getting away with everything and nothing's going to be made right, when in reality, it will be made right in God's time. Secondly, realize that God gives us opportunity, right, and my opportunity might be different than yours, and yours than the person across the aisle, right? God, and we've talked about this, we all have a sphere of influence. Right, we all have the opportunity to help in certain aspects. Some of it collectively, like all of us were able to just recently help people who had lost food. And then, like I mentioned last week, it's a very simple sort of process. I was reading an article about folks who, you know, lost a couple $100 worth of food in a freezer, and that was forever, right, for some of these folks on a fixed income to replace. And I thought, well, maybe we'll make some phone calls. And Lord opened some doors, we're able to do that. And it's, you know, a huge, but it was very simple, right? It wasn't, you know, the light shone down from heaven and spelled out, you know, call retirement homes. You know what I mean? It was just, it is our goal. And so God will give us opportunity, right? So we can choose to respond in order to experience God's best. If we want to experience God's best in our lives, it's going to have to do with serving and being a part of the lives of other people. And again, the ability for us to do that might vary, but and where God calls us, but nevertheless, he does call all of us. And then last but not least, we will see that when we live rightly in God's plan, we can rest and not keep looking over our shoulder. I remember years ago, the the wisdom of grandfathers, right? I was driving one time with my grandpa on Imperial Highway, I still remember, almost across the street. I was sort of making fun of him, to be honest with you, because he never drove over 55 miles an hour. And I'm like, Grandpa, you know, you could at least go 60 and not get stopped, right? And he goes, Stephen, I drive 55 and I never look in the mirror. And I'm like, you know, in other words, do the right thing and you don't really have to worry. You know what I mean? And so when we live rightly in God's plan, we can rest and not, have to look over our shoulder. Realize that we're safe in our Father's arms. Right? We're safe in the arms of our Heavenly Father. And we'll see that here in this passage. Jump back with me to our study. And, you know, because at the end of the day, we know where we're going, right? And we're not, you know, we don't have a death wish. We're not wanting to die before our time. We're not trying to expedite that by any means, right? But it is a reality. I mean, everybody dies. And so the question is, are we really living? You know, and so when we live in the Lord, in the light of eternity, we live in the Lord's plan, and we maximize life here on this earth. And we don't have to keep looking over our shoulders. We're going to realize here that that wasn't the case. Pick it up in verse 14 for this king. That's Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, right? So they had just declared him king. Jehu, verse 14, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, conspired against Joram. Now, Joram, with all Israel, had been on guard at Ramoth Gilead against Hazael, king of Syria. But King Joram had returned to be healed in Jezreel. Remember, he'd gone to battle and been injured, so back here to recover of the wounds that the Syrians had given him when he fought with Hazael, king of Syria. So Jehu said, if this is your decision, then let no one slip out of the city to go and tell the news in Jezreel. Then Jehu mounted his chariot, and he went to Jezreel. So he's on his way. He's going to go. He's owning his call, right? And that's important for us, too, by the way, right? Whatever that call is, right? He's owning his call. And so then Jehu mounted his chariot, went to Jezreel, for Joram lay there. And Ahaziah, king of Judah, had come down to visit. So there's these two kings there. And so, you know, it wasn't like today where they have satellite images of who's coming or drone coverage or, you know, high def, you know, cameras that can help you see who's out there. They had watchmen. So verse 17, the watchman was standing on the tower in Jezreel and saw the company of Jehu as he came. And he said, I see a company. And Joram said, take a horseman and send to meet them and let them say, is it peace? So you can see already, he's here recovering, but he's a little sketchy, right? But there's a rider coming. They can see the rider. They can't see who it is. And so they send out a horseman to go clarify, are you coming in peace? He's sort of on guard, right, for good reason. So a man on horseback went to meet him, and he said, thus says the king, is it peace? And Jehu said, what do you have to do with peace? Turn around and ride behind me. In other words, nope, it's not peace. I'm gonna be the king now, so you can either join me or suffer the consequences. So the watchman, turn around and ride behind me. The watchman reported saying, the messenger reached them, but he is not coming back. Normally he would come back and deliver the message, right? And Jehu was looking for the message. Yeah, it's peace, don't worry. Then he sent out a second horseman who came to meet them and said, thus the king has said, is it peace? And Jehu answered, what do you have to do with peace? Turn around and ride behind me. Everybody had known the wrong of the house of Ahab. Everybody, you know, back in 1 Kings 19, had already been predicted that Jehu, or foretold, really, that Jehu would be king. And so now he's coming, and perhaps these guys knew that. So verse 20, again, the watchman reported, he reached them, but he is not coming back. And the driving is like the driving of Jehu, the son of Nimshi, for he drives furiously. So this guy was known to be passionate, right? And just by they couldn't see his face, they couldn't identify who it was, but by his demeanor, they speculated, oh, it's Jehu. So Joram said, make ready. And they made ready his chariot. Then Joram, king of Israel, and Ahaziah, king of Judah, set out, each in his chariot, and went to meet Jehu. and met him at the property of Naboth, the Jezreelite. Remember, now we're getting pretty specific on that prophecy about where the judgment would occur. And when Joram saw Jehu, he said, "Is it peace, Jehu?" And he answered, "What peace can there be so long as the whorings of the sorceries of your mother Jezebel are so many?" So you can imagine Joram's heart dropped. He realized, this isn't going to go well for me. And he's calling to remembrance the wrongs of Jezebel and of the house of Ahab. Joram turned around and he fled, saying to Ahaziah, "Treachery, O Ahaziah." And Jehu drew his bow with full strength. In other words, he kind of cranked it. It's not like the compound bow that we get to shoot today, right? He cranked this thing back, what we call it, a recurve, right? Those of you, yeah. And pulled it all the way back, and he just let this thing fly. In full strength, and he shot Joram between the shoulders so that the arrow pierced his heart, and he sent him his chariot. Jehu said to Bidkar, his aide, "Take him up and throw him in the plotted ground belonging to Naboth to Jezreel." Remember, Naboth was the neighbor who Jezebel connived against to have him killed, basically, and take his territory because Ahab wanted it. And it was foretold that you would be judged there. And so it's interesting. He had fled, and Jehu says, "Take him back and dump his body there." So he understood what was to happen, right? God allows us to be a part of his plan at times. So throw him there. "For remember when you and I rode side by side behind Ahab, his father, how the Lord made this pronouncement against him. As surely as I saw yesterday the blood of Naboth and the blood of his sons, declares the Lord, I will repay you on this plot of ground. Now therefore take him up and throw him on the plot of ground in accordance with the word of the Lord." And when Ahaziah, the king of Judah, saw this, he fled in the direction of Bethdagon. So he's like, whoops, I'm going to get out of here. Remember, he was the visiting king. Jehu pursued him, and he said, "Shoot him also." And they shot him in the chariot at the ascent of Gur, which is by Ibleam, and he fled to the ghetto and died there. His servants carried him in a chariot to Jerusalem and buried him in his tomb with his fathers in the city of David. In the 11th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, Ahaziah began to reign over Judah. When Jehu came to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it. This is going to show how vain she is. She should have, repented a long time ago, frankly. But she's going to be Jezebel to the end. When Jehu came to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it, and she painted, no doubt she knows what's coming, right? She painted her eyes and adorned her head and looked out of the window after she got her makeup and got, looking all queenly. And as Jehu entered the gate, she said, "Is it peace, you Zimri, murderer of your master?" So not exactly words of reconciliation, Certainly not repentant. And he lifted up his face to the window, and he said, "Who is on my side? Who?" So in other words, right, Jezebel, of course, would have had the eunuchs there. And who is on my side? And two of the three eunuchs looked at him. So even though they had been serving her, right, they knew what he was saying. And so he said to them, "Throw her down." So they threw her down. And this wasn't, off of a little step. This was a couple of stories. Some of her blood spattered on the wall and on the horses, and they trampled on her. The idea is the horses there, including probably the horse Jehu was on. But he was executing God's judgment, right? He was doing the right thing. It was a little messy, but he was carrying out God's judgment for her treachery and the many lives that she had caused and rebellion. And then he went in and he ate and drank. So he executes God's judgment and he goes in and has a meal. Whoever said the Bible wasn't interesting, right? This is good stuff, And he said, "See now to this cursed woman and bury her. For she is a king's daughter," so he's honoring that. But when they went to bury her, they found no more of her than the skull and the feet and the palms of her hands. Just like the prophecy predicted, right? In other words, the dogs had eaten her except for a few parts of her body. When they came back and told him, he said, "This is the word of the Lord, which he spoke by his servant Elijah the Tishbite. In the territory of Jezreel, the dogs shall eat the flesh of Jezebel, and and the corpse of Jezebel shall be as dung on the face of the field in the territory of Jezreel, so that no one can say this is Jezebel. And that was foretold. You know, sometimes, what is that movie about the flood years ago that came out in Hollywood, like, puts their own spin on it, right, and really minimizes God, or does their best to minimize God. If somebody wanted to make a super interesting movie, I mean, just take the Bible for what it is, right, and share it. So, anyways, we see here some principles that can apply to our time, right, that can help us to live in peace, right, to live free of fear. And that's not talking about the fact that, like as I mentioned earlier, doesn't well up inside of us, but to help us level set when that fear comes, to remember that God is still on the throne. He hasn't abandoned us, he hasn't given up on us, nor will he ever, right? God is still in control, and ultimately justice will be served. It would be, as I mentioned, it would be good for those who are committing these crimes today to remember that and to repent, but also comforting for us to remember as we might be tempted to be afraid. Realize that God gives us opportunity to be a part of his work of doing good on the earth. And if we want to experience God's best for our life, regardless of the time, you know, I mean, you think back to the normal challenges of life, and then you add 2020 to that. It's just kind of interesting, right? You know, I mean, we started the year off just probably somewhat abnormal sort of politics in terms of issues in our nation. And then you add, you know, pandemic and derecho and unrest and all this stuff. It lends itself to a lot of opportunity for fear if we allow it to be, but we can combat that by remembering that God is still on the throne, and that we have opportunity to do good, as we all collectively just did, to a degree, to help some folks, and a lot of other opportunities individually out into lives as well. And then remember, when unlike the king here, right? Unlike the king here, who wasn't living in peace because he wasn't doing the right thing. He wasn't honoring God as his lineage had not. But when we do live rightly in God's plan, right, we can live in peace. We can have rest. We don't need to look over our shoulder or be sketchy about what's coming, because we know that we're safe in our Father's arms. Again, it doesn't mean it's always going to be easy for us. It doesn't mean there's not going to be, you know, adverse diagnosis or adverse financial situations or relationship challenges or physical issues. It doesn't mean that we're not promised simplicity or ease in all those ways, but we are promised that God will be with us and that we are safe as we walk through those things. And so I want to encourage us, right? Be like Jehu, who owned God's call upon his life. That was a decision that he made. You know, we might have opportunities before us, but if we don't own it, you know what I mean by that? Right? Step out in it. Go for it. Pray. Seek the Lord. Seek wise counsel. You know, as a younger person, that was something I, you know, you think, what would you tell your younger you? Listen to people a little more. Maybe I used to. You know what I mean? You know, seek wise counsel and then step out. And, you know, people look for leadership. People need leadership. And you and I, as believers, can be a part of providing that, because we know the one who is on the throne. And so I hope that encourages us, right? Isaiah says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Therefore, trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord God is an everlasting one. Right? And we see a key principle in that. And that is, where is our focus? Right, go read Philippians chapter 4, kind of focus in on verses 8 and 9, you know, where God doesn't just tell us what not to do, he tells us what to do, what to think on, what to give our focus to. Right? And here we see the kind of the convergence of God's judgment and man's activity. Right? But for those who are following the Lord, we have nothing to do. So I personally want to be, to whatever degree God allows, part of the solution, right? Part of bringing the message of hope to, you know, whoever will listen, right? right? And we all, as I mentioned, have different spheres of influence, different opportunities to help communicate that with the world that needs God's hope desperately. Amen?
Thanks so much for joining us today in our study. Hope you were blessed and encouraged in the love that God has for you. Hope you found, you know, two or three nuggets that you can take away and apply to your life. Thrilled to have you join us online at our Facebook live stream every Sunday morning or through YouTube by subscribing to YouTube channel for Calvary Chapel Living Hope here in Iowa. Thanks so much for joining us. You are loved. Hope you are blessed. God bless you.